Thanks to Skillshare for supporting my channel.
If you're worried you might have COVID-19, a few questions can help you understand your situation.
Well, that might not have worked, but a recent paper out of MIT claims to be able to use AI to predict whether or not you have COVID just from you coughing into your phone or computer. But is this AI hype or reality? Today, we'll dive into that paper and see whether or not we'll be coughing into our phones for the foreseeable future. As you probably already know, one of the main visible symptoms of COVID-19 is coughing. And while we have applied artificial intelligence algorithms to a lot of other types of data in an effort to create diagnostic systems for COVID, such as chest x-rays and fitness tracker data, we haven't yet looked at the audio recordings of people's coughs until now. Or until last Thursday, when MIT News announced that this paper had been accepted for publication. The paper focuses on the development of an AI system that takes recordings of a cough, processes them to identify different biomarkers, which are indicators of a particular disease or biological state, and then learns to tell the difference between biomarkers of someone with COVID-19 and someone who doesn't have COVID-19. But how do they do this? Let's start with their data. Earlier this year, the authors put out a call for people to go to this website and submit recordings of them coughing into their phones or computers, along with some demographic information about themselves, whether or not they had tested positive for COVID in the last 7 days, and whether or not they had any COVID symptoms. The website also asked you whether you had self-diagnosed yourself with COVID if you hadn't gotten a positive test or been diagnosed by a doctor. But what if you didn't have to cough? Well, unlike peeing in a cup, in this case, you could just fake a cough. And we'll circle back to this approach towards the end of the video, but it's an interesting idea that has received some criticism from peer scientists. After all, one would expect that there's a difference between the sound of a cough that your body forces you to make in response to some sort of congestion or respiratory distress, and the cough that you force your body to make when you're not actually in any kind of distress. So after collecting several hundreds of thousands of data sets, the authors took all of the COVID positive recordings and an equal number of randomly sampled COVID negative recordings and used that as their data set. Let's take a look at their model next. Interestingly, the authors used a model that had already been trained to diagnose Alzheimer's disease in patients. Wait, we can use AI to detect Alzheimer's disease? Well, that's another promising maybe. See, the authors for this paper were originally working on this Alzheimer's disease model when COVID broke out, and when they realized that their model might have applications for COVID, they did a hard pivot when it became clear that we would need better COVID diagnostic tools. And it turns out that these conditions have more in common than you'd think when it comes to this model, which uses 4 different biomarkers to predict whether or not someone has COVID or Alzheimer's. The 4 biomarkers for this model are muscular degeneration, changes in vocal cords, changes in sentiment, and changes in lung and respiratory tract. The muscle degradation feature essentially looks at the force behind your cough to see whether or not you're experiencing muscle fatigue. Changes in your vocal cord biomarkers are often associated with different lung diseases, and changes in your respiratory tract and lungs are often associated with respiratory diseases, both of which track for COVID, given that patients with COVID-19 often have chest congestion or respiratory distress in response to the mucus buildup in their lungs. Finally, you probably wouldn't expect people with COVID-19 or Alzheimer's to be the happiest people on the planet, but it turns out that neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's and diseases with neurological impacts like COVID-19 can cause cognitive decline that can be measured via your sentiment. So after designing models to extract and classify all of these features, they finished their system by aggregating those different classifications together to predict whether or not someone has COVID. And from this paper, they're able to do that with 97.1% accuracy, with 100% accuracy on their asymptomatic data, which represents about 5% of the total data set. Also, as a note, there's a mistake in this figure caption, so if you try to read this paper and get confused about which line represents which data set, the blue line is for people who had positive COVID tests, and the orange line is for everyone who was marked as COVID positive, including people who self-diagnosed. The rest of the paper looks at how important each of these 4 features are to accurately predicting whether or not someone has COVID, with the lung and respiratory tract feature being the most important, and then seeing how removing different biomarkers affected the performance of their model. So, are we going to be coughing into our phones until there's a vaccine? Not yet. However, the authors are partnering with four hospitals around the world as part of an ongoing clinical trial to expand their data set and validate their model in clinical settings. They're also partnering with a Fortune 100 company to demonstrate the value of our tool as part of their COVID-19 management practices, which looks like another way they're planning to expand their data set in the meantime. They also specify that the best use of this system wouldn't be for diagnosing people who already have symptoms. It would be for surveillance testing or daily testing of asymptomatic users in order to get a better handle on how prevalent COVID is in your community. However, this does require everyone in a region to use this service consistently, which might become a significant issue in the areas of the world that need this kind of community testing the most. And it's generally difficult to enforce. Plus, it has some implications for surveillance testing in the more literal sense. A combination of facial recognition and microphones placed around cities could pick up COVID-positive people and then identify them, which has both personal privacy and ethical implications given the rather spotty accuracy of facial recognition systems across demographic groups. More importantly, can AI actually tell whether you have COVID from your cough? It's hard to say anything definitively, but I actually think this paper looks pretty promising. And not only because of the data that they show in the paper. The authors make a point of getting data from really diverse sources, from people who speak multiple different languages, have multiple different accents. And so in theory, this model isn't biased against any one nationality or accent. This does introduce another caveat, as 5,000-ish samples is probably not enough to cover that level of diversity, but the authors are actively working to expand their data set and maintain that level of diversity as they do so. Additionally, unlike a lot of cases of AI hype, they're actually going through the formal clinical trial process in order to validate their system so it can be used by the public safely. And that's probably what the collaboration with the Fortune 100 company is for, because clinical trials are extremely expensive, even for Harvard and MIT labs. Lastly, let's circle back to the issue of asking people to force a cough. I have mixed feelings on this, mostly because the website doesn't provide instructions on how to cough, so some people might be coughing daintily into the microphone and others might be hacking at their computer. But at the same time, telling people how to cough might introduce bias or have people cough in an unnatural way that removes some of the features that are necessary for this model to work. Basically, it's a bit of a catch-22. I don't think that forcing people to cough is necessarily bad data, but I think that it should be understood that that's not a natural cough either. In short, my take is that this is a promising start, and I'm excited to see where their clinical trial goes, but I wouldn't expect this to be on your phone by Christmas. I also think it's really cool and creative that they used an Alzheimer's model to detect COVID, because that's definitely not something that I would have thought of intuitively, and it seems to be working really well. In fact, while there have been some iffy uses of AI during COVID-19, it has been great to see people get really creative with their resources and applications to make systems that actually work in real life. If that sounds interesting to you, but you don't know where to start, you can get started on your creative journey with Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community for creatives where millions come together to take the next step in their creative journey for less than $10 a month. They offer thousands of inspiring classes for creative and curious people on topics including illustration, design, photography, video, freelancing, and more. Personally, I recently finished the iPhone filmmaking class because I was making a short film for something on my iPhone, and I learned a lot of great tips and tricks along the way. Skillshare members get unlimited access to thousands of inspiring classes with hands-on projects and feedback from a community of millions. And most classes are under 60 minutes with short lessons to fit in any schedule. If this sounds interesting to you, the first 1,000 of my subscribers to click on the link in the description will get a free trial of Skillshare Premium membership so that you can start your creative journey. Clicking on that link supports my channel and will get you started on your creative journey, so check out Skillshare's classes using the link in the description and show me what you make. Otherwise, if you like this video and would like to let me know, you can do so by smashing the like button and subscribing to my channel. You can also check out this other video I did earlier this year on how AI found COVID-19. Otherwise, you can follow me on Twitter and Instagram to learn more about my PhD life, and I'll see y'all next Monday. Bye.